So some 30 years ago, 37 years ago, a few scholars got together for what was called the Jesus Seminar. And their purpose was to determine to the best of their ability what the story of Jesus, what of the story of Jesus of Nazareth is historically accurate, or as some call it, what we can find about the historical Jesus, as opposed to the Jesus we find in the Bible, which, as I'm sure you can imagine, is pretty difficult to figure out for someone who existed 2,000 years ago, before computers and television, but as you might imagine, is of relevance to many people, Christian and not, who are interested in how the life of a young man in first century Palestine became the foundation of a religion that has shaped our world and shaped our country and inspired so many, from social justice advocates to those who war and persecute others. So all of us, in fact, have a stake in knowing who was this person. And this is a question that is, of course, very relevant to us as Unitarian Universalists, whether we consider ourselves personally Christian or not, because we are a faith that believes in finding truth and meaning, because we come from two Christian churches, because without this idea of Jesus, we might not exist as we are. A person who's depicted in our stained glass and who's quoted inaccurately or not on the beam above my head, which says, "And if I be lifted up from the earth, I will draw all men unto me," from John. And our Unitarian ancestors became Unitarian because they believed not that Jesus Christ was God, God's self. Yes, God is God's pronoun. But that Jesus was a man, denying the Trinity that most Christians believe in, which sees God as God the parent or the father, God the child, the son, Jesus Christ, and God the Holy Spirit. Yet if you ask many UUs what they believe about Jesus, you will hear them say that they think he existed, that he had some valuable lessons, but that they don't believe in his divinity. They see it as a story that we can find some meaning from. Now, of course, I don't mean all UUs. So as we make meaning from this story, there are actually two branches of this story that we're trying to make meaning from: the factual story, the history, as much as it can be understood, and the story from the Bible, the Christian scriptures, the story of Jesus from what is called the Gospels. And those are two things. Are you following me, right? The historical Jesus and the Jesus of the Bible. The Gospels, which are the first four books of what is generally called the New Testament of the Bible, which is the part that talks about Jesus, these four Gospels that are named after their presumed authors, and they tell the story of Jesus's life and ministry. They are the most important part of Christian scriptures. The Gospel, according to Mark, which we read from, is the one that scholars agree was written first, and it was written about 70 CE, which is about 40 years after Jesus's death. Right? So Jesus dies around 30 CE, and then 40 years later, this account of his life is written. Now, I want you to imagine with me for a moment an event that you either experienced 40 years ago, or for those of you who are less than 40 years old, something that happened about 40 years ago in your family. Right? So we're talking 1982. Now, try to write an accurate account of what happened. Be sure to include private thoughts and conversations that you weren't present for that are relevant to this event. Sure, you might have some sources, other people's oral or written accounts, maybe pictures, but do your best to recreate it. How accurate do you think you'll be? For me, a story in my life that is about that long ago is my parents' wedding. Now, I can imagine all sorts of things. They've talked to me about it. I can tell you that my father designed my mother's wedding ring, but I can't tell you how long they were engaged for. And so for the sake of the story, I'll say 1 year. I don't know what words they said when they got engaged, but maybe I'll think of something, maybe based on what I said when I got engaged. And I know that they got married in the Catholic Church, so I'll do a little bit of research and figure out who the priest was at a Catholic church in Ottawa where they got married. So you can see how this is a little tricky. And my parents' wedding, of course, is a monumentally important thing that happened in my life, right? Without it, I might not exist. So really we can understand how we can't really describe something that happened that long ago without getting the interpretations of people's memories and those around me. So I bring this up not to discredit the Bible, but to put it in the context of just how much of it is what is written and how much of it might have actually differed from the historical Jesus as he actually existed. Which doesn't make it any less important, right? What's in the Gospels and revelatory. As we often say here, scripture is everywhere. Now, some things in the Gospel of Mark are obviously fabricated to create a more compelling story. Some things in all of the Gospels. Mark's Gospel, the earliest one written, for example, does not include a narrative of Jesus' birth. For a simple account that there was no account of the birth of a peasant born to unwed parents in occupied land. Of course, that doesn't mean that we shouldn't celebrate Christmas for its message of divinity in all children, a promise of love and peace across the nations. Even if it did not happen in the way that it's described in the Bible, there is a human truth to it. We Jews can see that. And obviously, Jesus existed and he was born, so that was at least factual. When we get, however, that Jesus' teachings of his last week on earth, what's commonly described by Christians as Holy Week, and his death, we find ourselves in a very interesting place, where it is likely that these accounts actually happened in some of the ways that they're described in the Bible, right? Because sometime around the time that Jesus was 30 years old, his ministry became public, and he became an important figure in both a religious and political sense. So unlike the story of Jesus's birth, there was at least some factual accuracy to the shape of this last week of Jesus's life, leading up to his death. The resurrection, obviously notwithstanding. In fact, scholars from the Jesus Seminar refer to the pre-Easter Jesus as the one who existed as a political force, a movement leader in ancient Palestine, opposing Roman oppression of Jews, and who was very much a Jewish voice of resistance, and the post-Easter Christ, who is written about in the Gospels at least 40 years after his death. It is very much experienced as a presence, who's very much experienced as a presence in the life of these early Christians. And some might say that there was a resurrection that felt real to them in that they experienced his presence as they moved forward. And so that's important to think of those almost as two different people, right? The word Christ, in fact, was not Jesus' name as much as it was an honorific like doctor or reverend that meant the Messiah. So the Jesus of Nazareth of history and the Messiah found in Jesus Christ. And I have no doubt that what the Gospels wrote felt true to them. And it doesn't take away any meaning from it when there's a difference in this historical accuracy. The Jesus Seminar found really that there was only evidence for about 18% of what Jesus said in the Gospels. And the Gospel of John, from which this quote is taken from, is estimated to not have any accurate sayings of Jesus. But this quote is still a representation of our universalist ancestors who built this building and who believed in salvation for all, meaning they believed that all people were worthy, which leads us to our current belief, right, that all people are loved and divine and have inherent worth and dignity. Okay, so it may or may not surprise you, but I am a huge Jesus fan. I haven't always been that way, but these days, I can't get enough of this kind of digging into what happened. I love me some historical Jesus, I love me some biblical Jesus, and I think both point to a person who entered the gates of Jerusalem and was angry at the Roman occupiers and collaborators, the high priests and the elites who aided in this Roman occupation. A person who called for this higher level of justice, he called the kingdom of God. A person who, if he existed today, would very much be despised by many who claim that he is their savior. As Christian biblical scholars, Marcus Borg and John Dominic Crossan put it in their book, The Last Week, about Jesus' last week on earth. There's often a question asked, is Jesus your personal Lord and Savior? But it's more important to ask, is Jesus your political Lord and Savior? We Unitarian Universalists are fond of saying that we try to create heaven here on earth, rather than trying to figure out how to get into heaven, which, it could be argued, is what Jesus was trying to do. And his threat to those in power crucified him. But the historical Jesus and the biblical Jesus aren't the only Jesuses that I love. Yes, there was a third kind of Jesus that I love. I am a huge fan of pulp culture depictions of Jesus. I especially love anything that sets Jesus in our modern times and imagine how he would be portrayed. And so it might not be a surprise, perhaps, that this musical, Jesus Christ Superstar, is one of my favorites. And after 7 years of ministry, I finally felt it was time for us to do some music from it. But we did have to do a little changing around of the songs because our beloved music director Soren tested positive for COVID this week. And so we ended up with three songs that describe Jesus in a very personal way. A Jesus who was truly a man. A song from someone who might have been his lover, Mary Magdalene. A song where he prays about his ambivalence towards his upcoming death. And a song where his friends ask him to stop what he's doing so he doesn't get hurt. Of all of them, only Gethsemane has a scriptural basis. It's a moment from Mark's gospel that would have actually been impossible for anyone to witness. Jesus said, I'm going to go over there and pray, right? Nobody was there with him. So we know that somebody imagined what Jesus must have been feeling at that moment, not as a God, but as a human. Thinking about all that had led him to this point, his triumphant entry in Jerusalem, his opposition to these occupying forces, and the terrorism that Rome was about to unleash on him. Now, I'm incredibly compelled by this. I'm compelled by Jesus's fear of the Roman authorities, the fear that his friends have for him. In my life, I think about how people I love get worried about me if I go out to a protest. This is a million times more than that, right? I think about all of the times that activists have been out in the street with the Black Lives Matter movement or the water protectors speaking of living in occupied land. Defying governments, defying their own ideas of those in power. The thing about the story, though, the story of Jesus, both in the Gospels and historically, and even in a lot of in the musical, is this idea, the thing that gets that we get wrong is this idea that we have to suffer, that those around us have to suffer. But the thing is, Jesus and those who loved him, who were protesting their place in life, they did not want him to suffer. He did not want to suffer. The Romans and the high priests, they did not have to crucify them, but they were afraid of his message. And they actually crucified anyone who was a threat to their establishment. Those two other men crucified that day, they too were political prisoners. But Jesus, as he expresses here and his friends, didn't even want his disciple, Judas, to betray him. Even Judas himself feels mixed emotions. But the thing is that the Gospels were written afterwards, after the message of Jesus, which was not unique to him, of the beloved community, the kingdom of God, of life and love, had been resurrected, in essence, among those who kept his memory alive. This post-Easter Christ then had a resurrection, right? His messages continued despite the fact that he suffered, not because of his suffering. So this post-Easter Christ doesn't have to be at odds with the one who didn't want to die. What happened is not something in which Jesus had to die, not one where people have to suffering, but one in which we can make meaning if we do experience suffering. So this is really an important distinction. Saying that Jesus's death was part of God's plan or that suffering means that you should suffer is a dangerous theology. But saying that Jesus understands those who suffer and he sides with the oppressed, that is liberatory. And that is visible in both kinds of Jesus, perhaps in all three kinds of Jesus. So it doesn't matter. Should we be worried about finding this historical Jesus when we talk so much about you can find scripture everywhere? Yes, it does matter because truth and meaning are important, because factual accuracy is important in and of itself to see the history of our country and this church. But there are also truths in these other accounts, human truths, truths in fear of repercussions when speaking out against injustice in our workplaces, in schools, in our streets, truth of love or fear of one's loved ones, and ultimately truth in resurrection. The truth that sometimes after suffering, there is rebirth, but not that suffering is inevitable. So this Easter, I encourage you to think about all of these accounts of Jesus's life, the historical one, the one that gives us the truth about what happened politically, the scriptural one, maybe even these cultural ones. And think about how these help us understand the humanity of all of us and the divinity of all of us. So happy Easter, and let us say together, amen. Our next song is sung by Mary Magdalene and Simon, two of Jesus' disciples, who